Lord bless. We're going to have today Arena's testimony.
Arena, I'm sorry.
Could you, do you want me to ask you questions or do you?
Sure, I mean, you can ask me some questions, but I'm also good at talking, so whatever works better for you.
Okay, well, can you start from the beginning?
Okay, so I've always been strong in my faith. I was raised in a faith-based home, but the faith that I was raised in was not the truth. It was called Swedenborgian New Church. So it's a man that supposedly went to heaven and had these visions and came back, and they have the Bible, but they also have their books outside of the Bible.
And they don't believe in all the scriptures.
They do believe in scripture, but then they add their own thing to it, kind of how like witnesses do and some other faiths. But it's okay because God was always putting ideas in my head outside of what I was being taught.
Okay.
And I did deal with church abuse there. I was accused of child abuse right after my father had threatened me with a knife in my home. I would bring the kids up. The candles would be in front of the altar. I would bring the little kids up to put them out. He was a three-year-old. He got scared. He started crying. The pastor of the church then, who had come on after the other one had retired, who was a good pastor, he was a nice pastor, accused me of shaking him and telling him he had to do it, which didn't happen. So God led me away from there for a reason. And then the next sermon he had the next week was how God doesn't like liars. And I just looked at my mom and I was like, I can't stay here and listen to this. Mind you, I was 16 at the time.
Okay.
And when you turn 18 in that faith, that's when you confirm in that faith. So when I turned 18, I was sent a letter to talk to the bishop, you know, to confirm if I wanted to be in that faith or not. And of course I called and I explained what happened to me, and he said he still fully supported him. And yeah, so God leads you away from things for a reason. I truly believe that.
Amen.
I've been through a couple churches. There's been, like, you know, church changes. Sometimes that doesn't always work when you come together with other churches. It doesn't always work out the greatest. A friend of mine led me back to church. I had been looking for years, but I was a single. So I was a single mom. I got pregnant with my daughter. I was not in a relationship with the father when I was 21. And I decided to keep her and have her. He wanted me to get an abortion. I had other people telling me to get an abortion. And that was not what I wanted. And that's not what I felt God wanted for me in my life. So I was always strong in my faith. But when people ask me when I became saved, that's when I say I became saved. When I became pregnant with my daughter.
Okay. And how did that occur?
Just
letting you know, every 8 or 10 minutes, I'm going to have a little song break.
Sure.
Okay.
Not a problem.
Okay.
How did that occur?
Yeah.
It was a one-night stand. Okay. And I got pregnant, and I went and confronted him in person. And then a week later, he told me to get blood work, whatever I did, and he said, F me and F the baby. He didn't care who to walk on to get where he wanted life. So he was never involved in her life, nor was his family by their choice. It wasn't that I didn't want them in her life, regardless of how it happened. Because I didn't have a good father. My dad was mentally, emotionally abusive, and at times physically abusive my whole life. So obviously I didn't want that for my daughter, but that's not how it worked out. So I raised her in the faith, and as of 2 years ago, she's now shied away. I feel like my life has been a combination of Job and the prodigal child in the last 2.5 years. I lost my home of 11 years. My daughter went and lived with my brother and his wife. She accused me of things that didn't happen. She's now living with me and my cousin again. I live in my cousin's home. But she's still not a believer, but I have to love her where she is. And serving has always been a light no matter what's happened in my life. I've been serving since I was 11. Literally legit since I was 11 years old. It's always just been something that's brought me joy and peace in my spirit. And for me, it's always been, I like to say, it's helped me thrive and survive.
Okay, after you left the Swedenborg Church.
I joined another church when I was 22. And I was there till my daughter was about, I want to say, 5 or 6. We merged with another church, and that really didn't work out very well. The merge didn't really, we weren't really coming together cohesively as one.
Okay.
And that's why I left that church.
So,
And then I joined GBC, Glenside Bible Church, and I was part of that church for 12 years.
Okay, and that was a Christian church? That
yes.
was Bible-based.
Faith-based. Okay. Bible-based, mission-based, all that.
Okay.
But I feel like spiritually-wise, growth-wise, it's not where I'm meant to be anymore.
Okay.
And there's no shame in that.
Okay.
You know, I was at that church for 11, 12 years. They were an amazing village for me during the time my daughter was growing up, like support-wise and everything. But I just think spiritually, it's not where I'm meant to be anymore. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's spiritual growth.
When did you start having a relationship with the Lord?
Well, like I said, I was raised in faith, even though it wasn't the right faith. I definitely was given other ideas from the Holy Spirit within from a young age, other than what I was being taught.
Because Swedenborg Church, I don't think they believe in the Trinity.
No, but that's why I'm saying to you, I was given ideas. God was guiding me in other directions other than what I was being taught from a young age.
Yes.
You know, I would question, even at a young age. I've always been very loud, I've been told, and intense. I've always, and as I became older, I've really found my spiritual voice, and I use it. And so a lot of people don't, not everybody does. I like to say I'm very awakened spiritually. Not everybody is. So I use it. If I see something that's not right, I could meet somebody I don't know, but if the Holy Spirit puts me that they need to hear a word from him, I will go up and speak.
So already when you was in Swedenborg Church, you felt like
there was
something wrong about the teacher.
Yeah, that there was like other ideas that God was just giving me in my spirit and my heart outside of what I was being taught.
Yeah, because supposedly he had these revelations.
Yeah,
by
so
angels.
I know all about it. Yeah. My family is heavily ingrained. My great grandfather was a reverend in that faith.
Okay.
My mom was raised in Brenathen. If you go to Brenathen, Alden Road is named after my great grandfather. So it's very intricate in my family.
Let's take a song break and then we'll continue.
Sure.
Okay, we have Sister
Raina
with us. I just want to ask her a little bit questions about the Swedenborg Church.
Also known as New Jerusalem and New Church.
Yes.
So they believe the teachings from a man from the 1600s named Emanuel Swedenborg, supposedly he went to heaven, God gave him visions, and he came back and he wrote books outside of the Bible called Heaven and Hell.
Yeah. He was a scientist, so before that.
So they go by the Bible, but they also go by a lot of these teachings of, they believe the spiritual realm and the real world realm are like one, and they're together and they're connected, and so your loved ones are really still here and they're not gone when they leave, and it's very intricate.
They don't believe in the Trinity.
They don't believe in the Trinity.
They believe, I think, it is something about like a Jesus only or something, or somewhat like that.
It's been a while, but I just know they believe, like, I mean, they say they don't look at him as a prophet, but they have scripture from this man from the 1600s, which is what they base their teachings heavily off of besides the Bible.
Yes.
They have a ton of books that he wrote that they base a lot of their teachings off of. You know, it's just, it's way outside of faith base.
Yes, it's outside the the orthodox or the Christian beliefs of Trinity, and I don't think he believed in hell, right? Or did he?
No, he did. He wrote books on heaven and hell.
Okay.
That was the names of the books that he wrote.
He did?
That they correlate and kind of mix in with the scripture of the Bible.
Okay, so he does believe in heaven and hell.
Well, based on the books, I would assume, so.
Okay.
Obviously, I don't know intricately because I stopped going to that church when I was 16.
Okay.
But I know enough to know that it's not what it seems to be.
Okay. Can you let me know how did your relationship with the Lord came to be?
So, as I said, I was raised in a faith-based home. Even though I was taught the new church beliefs, God was always kind of tugging on my heart and spirit outside of what I was being taught about the path and other things. And I believe he did that for a reason from a young age. And I always kind of questioned what I was being taught, even though I was kind of like quieted. At one point, the new pastor had us separated from the whole church, all the teenagers. We were separated and put in the pastor's house and not allowed to be in with the regular adults. And then when I was accused of abuse in that church, which didn't happen, my mom and my grandmom and my aunt all had a meeting with this pastor. He said we were like spawn of the devil. We were horrible children. And it was sad because we were involved. We wanted to be involved in that church. And you would think that that was something they wanted to encourage. And instead, it was discouraged.
Okay.
But yes, I'm really thankful that God led me away from there. But so, as I said, I've always had a relationship with God. But when people ask me when I was saved, I became saved when I was pregnant.
When you was pregnant?
Yeah, so 18 years ago.
How did that occur? Talk a little bit about that experience?
I was not in a relationship with the Father, and I got pregnant. And I was told by a lot of people, including the Father, to get an abortion. And I knew, I prayed about it. I was really scared. I didn't know what I was going to do. But I knew that I needed to keep the baby. And I promised God that I would raise her in the faith, which I did. I didn't really think about it until like a couple years later when she was like 3 and people said, oh, well, how did you become saved? And I was like, oh, I never really thought about that question. So I definitely know it was when I had my daughter. My daughter was a breech. She was an emergency C-section. Her foot came out, but the cord didn't come out with it. And they said, the way they explained it is she was carrying the cord around her neck like it was a rope. She was never in distress. She was never, which is like a miracle, because I work in healthcare. I've taken care of kids where they lost oxygen and were cerebral palsy, autistic, all different types of things from that happening to them.
And she came out normal.
Perfect. Came out perfect. And I believe that was God's grace because I did what was right regardless of what everybody was telling me to, what I had a lot of people telling me in the wrong thing to do when I was pregnant with my daughter.
You never got involved into drugs or nothing?
No. So. My mom was very strict growing up.
Oh, praise the Lord.
But my mom did ingrain in me serving, and I like to say my mom taught me, I just amplified it by 1,000. And because I'm an abuse survivor, serving has always been a light for me in the darkness, no matter what I went through in life. I was also heavily bullied all through school, high school, junior high, elementary. And I serve with about 5 or 6 different ministries right now.
Five.
Yeah.
So let's talk you want to talk about the ministry that you serve. Can you
ministries.
So let's take a 2 minute break for a song, and then we'll start talking about that. All right.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. And what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. What peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Okay, we're back with Sister
Reina.
Reina.
You were going to say Arena.
I was going to say something else, I guess. I'm bad with names. When I was married, the first 4 years, I did not know my wife's name.
That's horrible.
So don't feel bad if I forget your name. Okay.
Shame on you.
Yeah. I used to call her Love and Beloved, but then.
Oh, that's
for the
nice.
First 4 years, but it was because I didn't know her name. But anyway, let's continue. We want to talk about where.
The missions I serve right now. So presently I serve with Victory One of Mabel for the Outside Food Pantry. Occasionally some other things they do. I got connected with them about 4 or 5 years ago. They do 31 Days of Hope every August, the whole month of August. I don't think they did as much. It was a little bit different the last 2 years, obviously, because of COVID. But my previous, I'll always call Glenside Bible my home church. Even like I still go back there occasionally, but that's how I became connected with Victory.
Okay, what church are you going to right now?
So I'm not really in a church. I'm more like fellowshipping. Tent Revival.
Oh, the Tent Revival.
So it's called the All Saints Evangelistic Movement. But we also meet. We go to different churches, and he like you know raises support. We also meet in somebody's house every week. We have, if I'm able, because I work overnight, they have Zoom meetings almost every day about prayer and scripture and worship.
Okay.
What's amazing, what I like about All Saints Movement is they believe in women in as pastors, evangelists, apostles, prophets, which I actually like. Because that says, if you look in the Bible, God didn't just use men, he used women too. Women were disciples as well. But so the it's called the All Saints Evangelistic Movement. They started their tent revival about 4 years ago.
Okay.
And we do six places. They added the sixth one this year. So we've already done Atlantic City, Camden. We're doing North Philly, McPherson, coming up in 2 weeks. And then we're doing Chester or Norristown first. Chester, PA or Norristown, PA. And one of them is first, I'm not sure. And then Harlem, New York is a new one that was added on.
Okay.
So that's done for about 6 months. And that's done every second Saturday of the month. And it's like praise music, testimonies. I don't know if you've ever seen praise dancing.
Yes.
Yeah, they do like praise dancing. It's very powerful. I'm actually the director of donations for clothing. So that's my, as he put it, my ministry. that I do with them.
Okay, is there a website that
you want on Facebook.
Oh, they're on Facebook?
Yeah, they're on Facebook. All Saints Evangelistic Victory is also on Facebook.
Yes.
Angels in Motion, they have a group page. They are not faith-based per se, but they give out what are called blessing bags. And in the blessing bags, there are 5 snacks. There's information for rehab and detox. And there's an encouragement card like, we love you, don't give up. And they know us down here. Like, there's a line waiting before we even get to the location, waiting for us. And we go out a couple. I'm a part of the Wednesday group. They are, I think, Wednesday, Saturday, Sunday, if I'm correct, down here. We come like Huntington, McPherson. We go to some of the tent cities sometimes.
Is there any events that...
we do every month, the fourth Monday of every month in Happer Horsham. And I think there's one in Atlantic City, somewhere, Atlantic City branch. They have what are called blessing bag parties that anybody can attend.
Okay.
And or they can do them outside of their, they can do them in their churches. They can do them with their Girl Scout group. They can do them at home as a family.
Okay.
Whatever they want to do. And they can get in contact with somebody through Angels of Motion like me or somebody else. And we can get the blessing bags to Angels of Motion. But they bless the people of Philadelphia. Okay. The people with addiction, the homeless, but also anybody in need that walks by and needs one, we give them. We're pretty sure they probably have at least one family member that probably has addiction issues.
Okay. That sounds good. Anything else you want to mention? Any other?
Well, there's so many amazing ministries down here. There's a mission down here called Castor Cares. It's right across from St. Francis. They usually do dinners, like once a week on Saturdays. They have a food pantry as well, an inside food pantry. I've worked with them pretty heavily over the years as well, off and on. So there's a lot at Refuge Hub. I work with an organization called Refuge Hub. She's more like seasonal holiday, but she might be blessing. What's amazing, what I love is I intertwine the missions I work with. Like, Victory has helped me bring food to a street that I got to know from a former friend of mine called Blakemore Street in Germantown, Northeast Philly, that is really struggling. And I know the team leader of the block. And if I fill up to it, I'll call her, I'll say what we have, and then I bring it down to her. All my missions kind of work together and they intertwine, that one will help me with another one because they know that I'm faithful to them and they know what I'm about. So they help me with other missions I work with, which is amazing.
That sounds good. I guess we're done for today. Thank you. Lord bless everyone, and I'll see you in the next program of Mr. Kakalides and the Bible Podcast. So long.